Коллеги, разрешите продолжить нашу секцию.
Dear colleagues, let's continue the section. David, in his speech, gave us a bridge to the next presentation, and now, well, Intel is well known to everyone. Intel is related mostly with to hardware. However, today we have, he's not a guest, he's one of the important participants of the conference, those who support and sponsor the conference, Igor Kaloshin. He represents Intel Software, which is quite natural for software engineering conference. The floor is yours. Thank you, Evgeny. First of all, a small video. Good morning again, and we are going to talk about the Internet of Things and its relations to big data magic, to analytics. A few words about myself and Intel, why we're here and why we're talking about the Internet of Things and not about micro architecture of chips. I'm in Intel for 15 years, and I accumulated a lot of experience to stand here and talk to you and share with you. And besides, I have a hobby. In the last 2 years, I've been actively working with startups. Startups, you know the word. And it helps me to interact with a lot of interesting, enthusiastic people, and that helps me focus on technological niches. It's very difficult just to sit down and try to find out what it is all about, but if you want to invest your money, then you just have to go into detail and find out what it means. Technology, market, competition, investments stimulate learning. Internet of Things is a hot topic, and I tried to understand what it is all about. We used to say cloud. Now we say Internet of Things, IoT, without properly understanding what it is all about. Let me try to explain my view of this point. When Nikolai showed me the idea of this presentation, he said, we have three presentations about technology, about some technologies we would like to listen to, and the fourth one will be yours. Well, I say, let me try. Express your opinion. And this is my concept, ask your questions. It is based on Intel's experience into my, from it's based on my relations with SAP and other people like Michael Porter, who, you know him, I'm sure. Magic strategic tools and so on. Now, that's what we observe right now. The industry is changing, and is changing quickly and profoundly. And the most profound technologies are those that disappear. They disappear because they become invisible. They become part and parcel of our everyday life. David said in his presentation that all the screens have been removed. Can you work? No, you can't. Although 20 years ago, that was matter of fact. No screen. And you could work. Now we cannot. It's our DNA. So there is a dry definition of Internet of Things. It says, Internet of Things means devices connected to the Internet, integrating a lot of computing capabilities and using analytics to extract meaningful information. It's dry scientific definition. Devices, mobile, home, industrial, interfaces, connecting them together into one infrastructure that links them all to the cloud. This is the general concept of the Internet of Things. I like the definition provided by Michael Porter and James Heppelman in Harvard Business Review. They defined the Internet of Things as the third wave of competition, driven by or stimulated by information technologies. Going back in history, we could see that the first wave, back in the 60s and 70s, was all about general computerization. And the main application of computer technology was local, from the viewpoint of the value chain. People optimized and automated certain components or sections of the value chain, ERP at specific enterprises, at specific points of those enterprises, for example, accounting, assembling. Some components were automated. Then, if we look further at the 80s and the 90s, we see the internet, distributed networks, and we notice transformation of the entire value chain, end to end. We optimized delivery chains globally. We installed communications between R&D center in China and US and Russia. We transformed the competitive landscape and the value chain itself. But the products delivered through that value chain didn't change much. Now, in the third wave, IT is changing or transforming the products. The products themselves become smart, intelligent. Why? Because we raise performance of processes, everything is becoming smaller and smaller, everything is becoming cheaper, more available, we have smart sensors, we have better network technologies, we have cheaper and faster storage. All that makes it possible for us to have a new approach to the capabilities that seem to be unattainable. A few words about figures. Right now, about 85% of existing industrial devices are not connected to the internet. They are not connected. Even old, obsolete devices, with the help of new technologies, can become smarter. Talking about the growth of connected smart devices, in 2006 we had about 5 billion devices of this kind. By 2020, according to IDC, we shall have about 50 billion devices of this kind. Forecasts of different analytical companies may be different. IDC speaks about 50 billion, while Gartner says 200 billion. Well, let's leave up to 2020 and see how many devices we have. The volumes of data are growing exponentially. This is a general concept. We have things, we have infrastructure connecting those smart things, smart sensors, through data centers, through networks, and then the data has to be processed. Looking at this picture differently, in greater detail, we can see the following picture. We have a complex structure. Here we have things, smart devices, smartphones, cars, industrial sensors, SCADA systems, and then data goes through the entire value chain of processing, filtering, storage, and they get into the analytical systems. Why do I show this picture? To demonstrate that the infrastructure that links devices and end users that get final value is rather complex, and it includes a lot of elements, including the nodes responsible for data security, data integrity, authentication. Let me tell you why I show you this picture. The solutions offered by large vendors, including Intel, IBM, SAP, and others, are focused on providing the end user all the information needed.
And to have a chance to quickly deploy solutions. For example, Intel is an example, so that 70% of all the work has been done for you. And so we talk about integrated security, which is embedded, and then we talk about unmatched scalability, simple, so then fast time to market. All this is there. It's part of the system. Then remote manageability. So all these components have been done. But the most important issue we keep asking, if this is the final, if this is true, if this is a value, is this the end customer value? No, not yet. But this is the basis for to make your own so breakthrough solutions. So we keep saying at our company that we provide a kind of bricks in order for you to build on the basis of these blocks that we offer you. You build your own solutions and show it to the end customer. Then let's go back a bit and talk about what is a smart sensor connected to the web or to the network. So you can see this ladder. You can see shows the evolution or the development of different gadgets. So the first stage is the most simple, is monitoring. So monitoring is means that we have a certain device that reads certain information and can forward it across the network or somewhere into the cloud, to the computers, etc. And so the simplest example, so a thermometer that can provide information about the temperature to another readout, outside exogenous readout. And so then the solutions that Medtronic offers, so then embedded in the under skin, so small sensors that can actually measure the level of glucose in the bloodstream and send signals if the level reaches a dangerous level. And so this is it. So that goes into the network and so internet. Mm. So the most valuable component of this is we need to talk about the next stages. So then the next stage is control stage, control phase. So which provides a certain response of the gadget of the so concerning its own condition or the condition of surrounding connected logically connected gadgets. So for example, you wake up, you have this band on your wrist and it knows that you woke up and then you got off the bed and so then there is this interaction of the logic cooperation between the gadgets. So immediately the systems gets going. So then the signal can start the coffee machine, can start a pot, can whatever. Because the machine, they know that it's me who woke up, and so it knows that the coffee should be ready within 5 minutes after I woke up. So this system provides for a certain infrastructure and a logical interaction between these two gadgets, between your wristband and between the coffee machine. Then comes the next stage, which is the optimization stage. Optimization. Each next stage includes all preceding components, all preceding ones. Many gadgets involved in this optimization platform. So when the information is accumulated in a certain data center, small data center, and based on the analysis of the existing data and historic data, it makes decisions concerning the operation of the systems in as an aggregate entity, and then provides guidance, orders, instructions, and we can just make conclusions as to how we can we can use these systems in a more optimized and value-added fashion. Like an industry, for example, this Tesla car, right? And each car sends information to the central server, about the condition and the status of its electronic systems, and how the systems are being used, and how the car is being used, and is being driven. And so the central server processes all this information. This Tesla server does that, and in real time, on the basis of the processing information, so there's a feedback recommendations to the car. How to manage the car, systems in the car are handled, to optimize the car operation and the system, to optimize the systems operation of this car. Then the system becomes to operate in a self-sufficient mode, autonomously. That's the last rung in the ladder. So then full autonomy, meaning I can give an example, put it this way. So systems, for example, windmills, so they have lots of gauges, readouts that can transmit information. So then optimization level is there, definitely. So because they analyze the condition, the status of all the components, and keeping in mind its historic information concerning different, comparing against certain templates, and predicting that a certain component may fail in a certain in a certain time. And based on historic data, they can automatically so call a support group maintenance team to maintain a component or to replace it with a new one. So this is an autonomous, self-sufficient system in operation that does its own prediction and forecasting, but still requires certain man presence. But still, so the level of autonomy is quite high. And the final drive is for full autonomy. But without data analytics, without good analysts, so the last two stages, I mean optimization, autonomy, not available without that. I have thought up a term when I was Uberization. So I'm referring to Uber company, Uber, and in within the framework of the Internet of Things. I think that Uber is exactly the best the template or yardstick of quality usage of the Internet of Things. And how many of you are using Uber or Get Taxi or Yandex Taxi? Raise your hands. Can I see the hands of them? So what is this application for you? So first thing that occurs to you is convenience. Convenience method to call a taxi. But it's just the top, the tip of the iceberg. What do you like about the service best? That you don't have to call the operator or the cars come promptly? Okay, price is low, good, but I like it, and I'm amazed that the car comes within 5 minutes, 5-10 minutes a car comes, and that's a big strength. If we look historically at how the system has been, the companies that provided taxi services, how historically they have been operating. So for them to achieve such targets is physically impossible, just to get a taxi within five minutes. What Uber did? So the company came to the market in 2009. So now this company is active in 200 cities all over the world, and is valued at $40 billion. $40 billion company's valuation. So how a small company in 2009, it was a small company, managed to shoot through the roof, and then in turn the entire industry, solid as a rock, taxi business, turned it around completely. And the company from the very beginning, so they put stakes on analytics and the data processing. And Uber has one of the most data science center. If we look at the statistics, and it's in 2000 public domain information. In October 2014, 5 years after the company had been founded, they published 15 vacancies for scientists in the area of data science. So they were hiring them. And that's exactly what they did. So while in 2011 in San Francisco, it took less than 10 minutes for a taxi to arrive, then in less than 80% of cases. In 2014, this indicator went down to 97%. So in 97% of cases, a taxi comes within less than 10 minutes. Why? How? Because of the analysis of where and how the car should be distributed all over the city. To anticipate the customer calling. And then it's even more interesting. With the help of analytics and data, so the company successfully launched this car sharing program. And so in 2014, the company announced that by way of issuing recommendations to the drivers where to go, just providing these recommendations to wait for the order to be completed, which is not yet there, and so the certain fleet of taxis and a fleet of increased the revenue by 5%. So then Uber, Boston administration turned to Uber for help, and based on the data traffic situation, so and about the traffic loads of the cities. So now they're building new infrastructure, transport infrastructure. So because they turned to Uber for this information, because they knew the traffic loads in different streets. So that's why to derive the maximum value from the information we have. Internet of Things, optimizing, analytics, data analytics is everywhere. It's ubiquitous now in all industries. We have a SAP colleagues here. So I visited their lab recently. They showed me wonderful solutions that prove once again the theory that without any. So that this so solutions are in demand. I spoke about the power sector. So windmills, I spoke about it. So then in retail, it's very much in demand. Transportation, this technology is in demand. Industrial manufacturing optimization, retail, energy, smart building. So let's talk about some examples from travel industry. So the company made a decision. One of the companies made a solution for British Airlines for Delta. They developed a solution. So the solution is as follows. So what is the most serious challenge for an airline? The planes get delayed. People have to be compensated for the cost of the tickets. Or give money to offer them accommodation or food to stay the night, or just put them on different flights, etc. It's quite dangerous. So then SAP came out with a new solution that takes into consideration a huge data collected from the from the planes, from the aircraft, so forecasting at which point in time so the aircraft might be delayed. Knowing, anticipating that information of the passengers who are in the airport, so who are going to take the flight that is going to be delayed. So they know exactly. So in the event of a delay, so the system can analyze so how many passengers, what will be the cost of compensation depending on the delay. So for the passengers who are at the, so that's why they suggest that they should change a flight beforehand, even before this delayed aircraft is landing, so that upgrade the ticket, put them in the first class, so for the passengers without waiting. So this comprehensive system, the predictive system, that helps them. It's impossible without quality analysis. It cannot be done. And there are some other examples offered by Intel in August this year. So we had our regular Intel Development Forum, and I wanted to show you this slide so that you would understand the main slogan. So the most important is not what the company does, but what you do, owing to the instrument and solutions that we offer. So developed by you, it's a new slogan. So which is the main slogan of the company right now. So what do we do? Okay, let's talk about very popular wearables. So very popular buzzword. So very interesting IDC statistics starting from 2014. So for the forecast, so we can see very burgeoning growth of wearables. So this forecast of growth is quite impressive. It's a good, robust growth. So the majority of those devices will have to do with fitness, wristwear, eyewear, modular clothing, iWatch, it's out there. So, but what are the challenges there? If we look at the experience of and the statistics that we know about the sales of Apple's watch sales, and the fitness bands, Fitbit. Apple Watch. At the beginning, there was a boom of sales, and now spike of sales. But now the number of the sales dropped. So the geeks were crazy to buy, and they bought them, and then the sales dropped because the customers, they don't understand why I should have yet another device that costs $500. So which actually repeats the smartphone functionality, but on top of it, but it's less convenient than a smartphone. They don't see the logic, and I think that they see this problem in the company. And if you look at the statistics of Fitbit, so then you can see that more than half of the devices are not in use. Those were presents, or someone tried it and didn't like it, so but a professional athlete understands what happens in his body. Where there are more complicated systems, professional devices, but a non-professional, so he gets tired of using this Fitbit devices. What's in it for me? They start asking. Okay, I see my pulse rate. Okay, so what? So I can feel it that my pulse is racing. It's no problem. And then they're trying just to figure out how to demonstrate the value of this new wearables segment, the new value, quite challenging. And the end user, the customer, needs to be convinced. So what is it that it gives me? Why Intel and vis-a-vis Internet of Things? In Intel, we have a special department, which is Internet of Things group, we call it. And so in this group, its revenue is rising. Now it's about 4% of the company's revenue. If you compare to the sales of servers and other devices. Mm. But for us, it's a very important area because it's on the rise. So and it shows good dynamics, 10-15% year on year. And so we fully realize that in order to properly occupy its quality niche in the area of the Internet of Things, we need to make products that would be geared to this market, fit the market. One of the good examples of properly thought out approaches to wearables is the development of this little microchip, which is called Curie. Curie. It's a very tiny little gadget that the size of a button, which has very good. The energy efficiency is high, the performance is high, and this little gadget can. So it's always listening, and it has some software that can identify certain patterns that occur with the device that is part of it. So that's body behavior, so running or. During the person's sleep, so this little chip can define the body IQ, social IQs, identity IQs, time IQs, and then trigger certain when it reaches a certain threshold, so it tells the owner what to do, and so then they get more energy efficient, they get smaller, and so there is a progress here. Mm. And not very expensive. So this little gadget, so this fully fledged mini computer, so is $2. So what can be done? So now about the value. What can be done for this kind with the help of these sensors? Something useful that would be valued by the customers. In the most recent IDF, we made this demonstration, BMX Sport Extreme something. Anyway, I This is where they show different stunts, riding bikes. So we made this interesting display, and we put it in the seat, and then the handlebar of the bike, and connect it to the Curie modules integrated into handlebar and the seat. So then we would put professionals on bikes and the winners. So winners of world events, and in real time the users could see how what moves of those professionals, but what do they have to do to do these stunts very very smoothly, and how they move. That's a good example of how that it could be in demand. So that's a vivid explanation of how it can be used in the area of athlete training, for example. And there are no yet not enough solutions that would show the apparent positive nature of these little devices and how it can impact positively. So, for example, how do you need to change the way you move, for example, the way you ride the bicycle to achieve better results? And so these little things can help the athlete to do that. So to use this so that I could collect all the information needed. So after the event, for example, after the game, or about my actions, my moves. So how fast I ride, how fast I turn around, and how high I jump, and that's it. And this information and it would be great, and then to compare it, to backtrack this information, and to compare it, to match it with the similar actions of a professional. And that is these solutions and software solutions. So they deliver an outlook on sportsman results and progress. Now, let me sum it up. So summing it up, so let's talk about the future professions. In my view, so one of the most intriguing and exciting and demanding professions will be the so then we need data science professionals. Very important. So because the analytics, big data analytics, in the Internet of Things realm. And according to the forecasts of some sources, it grows by 30% year on year and will continue to grow at the same rate. And for the next 5 years, minimum. And the number of required professionals in the area of data analytics is on the rise, sustainable rise. And only in the US by 2018 there will be a shortage of 180 specialists in the data science area, only in the United States, so 180,000. And then, what's the conclusion? We need to think to what extent, how good you are, and how well you use your data now. Questions? Еще 2 минуты. Data science. Voodoo science is the work of the con artists. Let me talk about these witch doctors. So this is a counterfeit, and this is the Michael Bell, the con man's work. And so when we started out the prototyping of how this Intel Curie should be designed and developed, in which way, what it should look like. So I purchased some wearables myself. And at the time they were available in the market, and I tested all of them. And then he was a rich guy, and so he has a sports car, and so with very very hard suspension. And the best test for him was San Francisco to my office, my headquarters, in the Silicon Valley. And all the watches that I bought, so they counted 2,000 steps. Only one watch, Basis company watch, that later we purchased. Yes, and integrated in our company. And so they counted to 2,000. So this is the Voodoo Science. And so how we bought bases, because it counted the moving correctly.
From the point of view of Intel, how are these two factors, M2M and OT, IoT, how do they relate to each other? M2M, I think, is part of the IoT concept. It's subsystems of IoT. It is focused on machine-to-machine communications, while the main problem now is not sensors or software that has to support interaction logic. The main point now, the main challenge now, is lack of high-quality communication channels that could support fast interaction between machines. Right now, I don't know whether we adopted the 5G network concept or not, but that 5G concept means that we have to support machine-to-machine communication as such, where we could minimize delays, latency. Today, M2M cannot be implemented in full, because if one machine sends a signal, it will take some time, too much time, for the signal to get to the second machine. So 5G networks will be a cornerstone of M2M, machine to street light communication, for instance. Can Intel Curie be tested by simple developers? Simple, no, but very soon they will. In our office in Moscow, we have two units only, but it will take us about 2 months to provide you all with the units, with the boards. They will be widely available. In all supermarkets for $2? No. Now, availability to developers, that's what I'm talking about. In the market, maybe in 2016, general availability, that's what I expect. If you have interesting ideas about Intel Curie technologies, please come to us and we shall help you to get Intel Curie faster than anybody else. You told us that Intel has a 70% ready IoT solution. Intel has all components, all the components. All components for infrastructure, IoT infrastructure, which, so to say, can save about 70% of time for implementation of the system. So we have the building blocks. The building blocks are ready. I told you that you shouldn't reinvent the wheel. The main value is not in the infrastructure. Infrastructure helps you, just helps you to raise security, to raise scalability, and so on. The main value comes from the right choice of sensors, the right choice of smart devices, and analytics. And for example, It's a practical question. Yes, how can we get acquainted with the Intel solutions for the full-scale development? Have you got integrated solutions? Where can we get usecaseintel.com/IoT? That's the point. Everything is quite easy. Google it. What should universities do to train data scientists? Has Intel a concept about data science? It's not an Intel concept, it's my personal concept. The number of data science specialists, the number of, well, demand for data scientists will grow. And we have a lot of universities, and they train people to do that kind of job. You can ask them. They have been training such people for some time. We lack the companies, the enterprises lack understanding of the fact that the data they collect can bring about very interesting incomes that could be monetized. You can find trends, areas for optimization. 90% of data is just collected and never used. Last question, if you please. I am not going to give you the exact, precise figure about power consumption. As soon as the processors are available, you'd better resort to independent evaluations. The concept of the system is based on the fact that the CPU quark, which is the heart of the embedded system, is almost always in the sleep mode. It is not used until DSP sensors will make that central system work, depending on some external triggers. So we're talking about days rather than hours of unbreakable operation. It's days rather than hours. Something like that. I said everything, but for embedded wearable electronics, point one is value, point two is if it is not comfortable, no one will use it. If you have to charge your watch every day, it's not feasible. I'm talking about days, while weeks, or months, a week is better than day. There are some technologies of wireless charging, but I don't know the exact answer. It's interesting to me also. So let's shift discussion to the hall. Thank you. Thank